This is Jean Friedman, Content Manager for RSA Conference. I am very pleased to introduce Jeff Jones and Tim Raines, who are updating their highly rated session from RSA Conference 2012, Code Red to Zbot, 10 Years of Tech, Researchers, and Threat Evolution. Recently listed as one of 25 most powerful voices in security, Jeff Jones is a 24-year security industry professional that has spent the last several years at Microsoft helping drive security progress as part of the Trustworthy Computing Initiative, working with enterprise CSOs and Microsoft's internal security teams to drive practical and measurable security improvements into Microsoft's process and products. Tim Raines leads product management in Microsoft's Trustworthy Computing Group. Tim and his team of product managers support the Microsoft Security Response Center, the Microsoft Malware Protection Center, and the Microsoft Security Engineering Center, and that includes the Security Development Lifecycle and Security Science Groups. I will now turn it over to Jeff and Tim for the presentation. Thank you.
Thanks, Jean, and thanks to everyone who could join us today. This is Jeff. Since we're not standing in front of you, I'll try to identify ourselves as, as we switch back and forth when we're talking today. Thanks for that great introduction. I sound exciting based on that introduction, Gene. So we do have a little bit shorter time today than we had at RSA. This was a 70-minute presentation. So we'll try to compress it a little bit. Based on our judgment, but I also want to reiterate what Gene said and encourage you to put your questions in as we go along. We have a couple of people here helping us, and so they'll monitor those questions. We'll be able to see them as we go along, and if we can just answer them in the context of what we're presenting, we will try to do that. So that if we don't have too much time at the end, we'll try to answer those questions. And then if we answer it, that'll allow you to change your question and submit another one. So Jeff and Tim, let's see if I can get this working. We'll move forward. Okay. So very briefly, I won't go over my own credentials again. Gene did a great introduction. I have been in security almost 25 years now. That's pretty much all I've done since I got out of university. I worked at Trusted Information Systems. I worked at a federally funded research center. Worked on early firewall stuff, including Firewall Toolkit in the 90s, and I worked at McAfee at one point, worked with PGP at one point, so I've been around security for a while. I'll let Tim talk a little bit about his background.
Sure. Thanks, Jeff. This is Tim Raines. I've done a lot of things in my career. I've spent the last almost 15 years at Microsoft, working mostly sort of in security and in networking, the two loves of my professional life. And most recently, I've just spent the last 5 or 6 years in trustworthy computing, focusing on threat intelligence and secure development, security science, and the security centers that we have here at Microsoft, the Microsoft Security Engineering Center, the Microsoft Malware Protection Center, and the Microsoft Security Response Center.
Okay. Thanks, Tim. All right, so quickly on session objective, if you haven't realized it or heard it, that we've just reached 10-year milestone for Trustworthy Computing, the initiative that it really got me to join the company, an effort to try to improve security, privacy, and reliability of products across the company. So we hit 10 years this year, and as we were doing planning earlier in the year, Tim and I got together and said, we work on security intelligence reports. Both of us are contributors. We do those every 6 months and do trend data for the last few periods. And we thought it would be really interesting with that 10-year theme to look back over 10 years, for the longer perspective. And we got to thinking about it and, what has changed. And really a lot has changed in 10 years. So this turned out to be a really interesting project for us. So we're going to go over some of the trends. I'm going to do industry vulnerability data. Tim's going to do the much more interesting malware trend data. We're going to talk about lessons learned and hopefully have a little fun. So the one thing I will say, this is what we said at RSA as well, we're both kind of data geeks, so we have a lot of fun talking about this stuff, and, you know, if that's not your thing, you might not have quite as much, but hopefully, you know, you registered for this session, you kind of know what you're getting into, and that you'll enjoy it. Strongly encourage you to ask questions as we go along, though. All right? So with that, I will jump in. We're going to do a little bit of then and now. I'm going to compress this pretty quickly because of time. I'll do vuln trends. Tim will talk about malware. We'll talk a little bit about applying it, and then we'll hopefully have some time for Q&A.
All right, one of the things that we did at RSA in San Francisco this year as part of this session was release the new 10-year version of the Security Intelligence Report. So a lot of what we'll talk about in today's session is based on this report. This report's actually pretty cool because, you know, Jeff did an analysis of 10 years of vulnerability disclosure trends, which I haven't seen before, and is pretty illuminating when you take a look at it. And then we took a very close look at malware trends over the last 6-7 years. Some of the trends that we've had, you know, we've talked to folks in the Microsoft Malware Protection Center that worked out in the industry for many years. You'll see some of the trends go back 20 years, but we focus mostly on the last 6 years of malware trends because that's what we have the best, most solid data on. And so you can already download this report. Again, it was released back in February at microsoft.com/SIR. But most of what you'll see today is in that report, and then Jeff has done some extra analysis that's also included.
Thanks, Tim. All right. So very quickly, I just want to set a little context, because until we start thinking about it, you don't think about how much has changed in 10 years. You know, there was a little bit of video conferencing software 10 years ago, but it wasn't used a whole lot. And now things just like this webcast are an example of things that are much more common. We do a lot more of video meetings now than we did then. Moving on, wireless. If you think back 10 years, I don't think I quite had my first broadband contract with an ISP yet, but I certainly had dial-up for a few years. But everybody was excited about getting broadband brought out to their home, DSL and such. Now, you know, my kids take for granted that they can just connect their wireless device pretty much wherever we go. And that's a pretty drastic change when you think about computing in general, but certainly security issues. Mark, I'm having a hard time with this. Can you? I'll just say, can we move on or whatever, if you can do it. All right. So I think about faxing as an example. You don't immediately align that with sharing via the cloud, but the types of things, I just went through refinancing my home and the ability to just pop things up on the server and automatically via email share it as opposed to faxing documents over, a super big change. Let's move on. Chat rooms versus social media, you know, a lot of commonalities, a lot of differences. One of the big differences is how many people participate, right? And social media is something that home users, consumers, my kids, everybody participate in. So the conversation's gotten broader, richer. Let's go on. And then cloud storage. I'm actually pretty excited about some of the things that are anticipated to come out over the next year, but even if I look back at the past couple of years, I use Mesh. You know, my wife's work uses Dropbox. A lot of collaboration enabled by this sort of thing. And then the cost just driving down as well, even on regular hard drives. And then even on the hard drives, you know, now portables, the amount I paid for probably I don't even know what it would have been 10 years ago, but it certainly probably wasn't in the gig range. So let's go on. And then PCs to multiple devices. This is pretty massive. You know, I'm trying to think if my parents had their first PC 10 years ago. They might have. They might have actually just gotten their first one and were looking at dial-up, which they didn't use very often. And now I compare it with the number of devices I'm carrying on me, you know, whether I've got my smartphone here, I have Kindle Fires at home, I have the PCs, I have home PCs, so it's just multiple devices. And really, my environment is pretty uniform across them because I use a lot of the cloud services to make that happen. So massive changes in computing there. So in summarizing that, before I get into the next section, the thing we called out as part of our 10-year milestone, the outreach we did, is really if we look back in the memo that Bill Gates sent 10 years ago to kick off the Trustworthy Computing Initiative, he had forecast, and then one of his statements is that within 10 years, computing will be deeply integrated into society and part of what everybody does every single day. And that has been fulfilled really just in an incredibly prophetic way. And that's each of these really is just highlighting that, how much computing and society have evolved together. So with that, I'm going to jump into the vulnerability trend data. So we'll go ahead in. In our normal security intelligence report, we do this in half-year periods. So we'll look at like what happened the second half of 2011, and the trending we look at is each half-year period going back. So I've personally pushed the internal team, Tim can attest to this, to go to yearly data because I think trends show up better. So I was really looking forward to the opportunity to look at annual data. So this is looking back 10 years. You can see that, 2,000 vulns a year back 10 years ago, that's a really big number, right? This chart makes it look small, but it's still a pretty big number. This is industry-wide, too. So this includes things in web-based services. So, you know, if there's a website that has a vuln that's attackable, that gets included in here. More traditional box product software, operating systems and everything. So it grew, peaked up in the 2006 timeframe, flattened out a little bit, and then we've had really a steady drop. I get asked about that a lot. Why is it dropping? Are there really less vulns? I get asked by people when we're talking about our security development lifecycle stuff, and there's a couple things about that context. One, Microsoft's typically less than 4% or 5% of this overall total. So even if our SDL was making us have go to zero vulns, it wouldn't affect this larger trend in this way. This is representing industry. So one, I do think industry is taking secure coding a little bit more seriously. We've seen a lot of proof points of that in the last few years. And Tim and I just got back from going to a SDL conference in Washington, D.C. So clearly people like Cisco, Adobe, things like that are having an impact. But it doesn't explain this trend. My own personal theory, it's only a theory, is that not everything's being disclosed, right? So there was a time period in that build-up to 2005-2006 where there was a lot of growth in the profession of security researchers, a lot more coming on board, and they were reporting every single thing they found, low, medium, whatever. I personally think a little bit of the pullback is the fact that people don't bother trying to find some of the low sev things that they used to, and so some of the pullback is just the fact that you'll see a huge percentage of the focus is really on higher or medium severity issues. So let's go on to the next slide, and you'll see that I do have the breakdown, and this reinforces my theory slightly, though I wouldn't say it's proof, but if you look, the green line is the low sev ones, and you'll see how they pushed up through the 2006, and there was growth in them along. And then the low sev ones have just pulled back to a relatively flat number, and I think largely reflect things that were just incidentally found and reported, and so they get classified. And more of the activity, more of the focus, being in that high and medium area. All of them roughly mirror the overall trends, though. So it reflects the activity of the industry, both on the development side and also on the researcher side. Let's go on. So now, one of the interesting things, as Tim mentioned, there's stuff we don't normally do in our security intelligence report. And since we started first publishing the security intelligence report, there's a ton of reports get published of this type of either threat analysis, vuln analysis, different things. And one of my personal pet peeves, I admit this is a personal one, is that I'll frequently see the data summed up and Microsoft's always shown at the top. Now, in the last couple of years, you've seen Apple be up there too. But if you look at the source data, that's really not particularly accurate. The data isn't being scrubbed. I understand why it's not being scrubbed for this particular aspect in some of the other reports because the malware information, other things are much more interesting to IT pros out there. But I posted out on our security blog today the data behind the charts I'm showing you. So if you go out to Microsoft Security Blog, it's at blogs.technet.com/security. Just posted up there today, and I post the raw National Vulnerability Database data, which I start from, all the links where I scrub data from, and then I posted a spreadsheet file that has the scrubs data. So you can actually, if you want to go out and look at those two things, pull them up in a spreadsheet, you can compare the before and after and filter on whatever vendors. I use the CPE names and things in there. But anyway, the end result is I wrote a special program that went through and ranked the top, did frequency analysis on the vendors that were contributing, did it for the last 10 years. These are the top five or six for 2011, and then I charted them backwards. So there were some that would have been higher than this in previous years, but I took the 2011 ranking and charted them backwards. So you notice the purple line there, that's essentially zero up through 2006, 2007, it's pretty low, 2008, and then it has hockey sticked up the last couple of years. So when we're doing this in person at RSA, I ask people to guess what that is that wasn't even there and then has now really moved up to, it's actually fourth on the list in 2011. And click forward, it is Google. So I also did product analysis on each of the vendors to see what contributed. So for Google, it's almost entirely Chrome. High overlap with WebKit vulnerabilities. Almost all of them would apply to Chrome OS as well. So that's where that came from. Let's move to the next one from the top. So at the top, I've got Enterprise Linux. You can see that blue line that's went across there. Just be very upfront there. The Enterprise Linux includes lots and lots of components that get wrapped together. The reason I call it out as a category is because I look at this when we're constructing security intelligence report, it's for enterprises typically, right? So it's people who are adopting, deploying, and maintaining their enterprise product. And so while from some theoretical viewpoint, people will come and argue with me and say, oh, well, that component's really from company vendor X or Y or whatever. Enterprise vendors pull these together and then commit to supporting the product for 5 to 7 years. And it's their butt on the line, if you will, for providing support. So those are the ones that have to deal with these vulnerabilities. And even if, in cases of like Red Hat or something, even if the component development team stops supporting the component because they've moved on to some newer version, they still have to do it because of their enterprise commitment. So that's thus the Enterprise Linux. I actually based this on Red Hat because they provide the best data in their advisories for scrubbing the database, but I didn't want to call it out because most of those components are shared across different Enterprise Linux distributions. So they're all going to be fairly common to that. Let's go to the next one. Second is Apple. If you look at that, they had a crossover there after 2006 where they popped up. I will say I only scrubbed their data rigorously back to 2005 anyway because their advisories weren't as consistent, didn't have as good vuln data prior to that. You can see that in 2008 they popped up to the top. Again, in 2010 they popped up to the top. It's not a huge surprise here. The Apple Mac OS X, now I include other things, patches for iPod, iOS, whatever, in that number. This is by vendor. But they share a lot of components, open source components, with the Enterprise Linux ones. So you see those start to track together there. It's not a surprise. Let's go to the third down. This is Oracle. This is actually the combination of Oracle and Sun. So if you look at the before and after data that I posted on the blog, you'll see that the raw in National Vulnerability Database data separates those, as they should prior to the acquisition. But things will be listed as Oracle whatever product or Sun whatever product, including Java. So when I scrub the data, because they're now one company, I combine those. So any place it was Oracle, I replaced it with Oracle Sun and vice versa. And you can see the combined one all the way back then, which is a fairly unique view. I don't think you'll see that from any other threat report. Let's move on down. I think we know who's coming up next. So you get Google is fourth, and then Microsoft's down at fifth this year. So, you can see we've we drove down when we first pushed, did some of the security pushes and things. We actually support, in the 2003 timeframe, 2004, we shifted from 5-year to 7-year to 10-year support commitment. From a Microsoft perspective, we're supporting a lot more products and 2 service packs on each of them than we used to. So that explains some of the volume going up there. Even so, it's relatively flat across there, other than you can see the little spike in 2010. Let's roll through. The last one then is Adobe. So they have driven up there. Interesting, if you look at, say, the 2006, 2007, 2008, 2009, 2010, you see a lot of tracking that's similar between Google, the purple line, and Adobe. But we also know that back a couple of years ago in the 2019 timeframe, Adobe adopted their own security development lifecycle and really put a focus on it. And so I think it's interesting that you see the Adobe number flatten off almost immediately and not continue that upward trend. So I think it shows some practical benefit that can happen. So let's go forward. I don't think we'll go back, but just on that last slide, I will say I don't have them on this chart, but I do have them in a blog post that you can look at the full top 10, 11, and that you see 10th on the list, I think, is Mozilla by itself, and 11th is the Linux kernel. I might have those reversed. The only reason I point that out is when people question that Enterprise Linux number and it being at the top, and that if you really take a small core set, it would drive it down in numbers. When you consider that the Mozilla browser, Firefox, and the Linux kernel by themselves make the top 11 list, that when you combine those in any Linux distro, it means that any Linux distro is going to be in there, even if you don't include any other components at all. So just for interest, I'm going to go through this quick. The NVD actually, they shifted to a schema 2.1 recently, and 2.0 has these common product enumerations. Really helped me in my analysis because they now identify affected products as being hardware, software, and on software they break down OS versus application. So this is just to show you that almost nothing ever shows up in hardware. It's almost all software, but there are some. And let's go to the next one. So this was great because we've in the past tried to do analysis in the SIR to break out browsers versus OS or applications versus OS. And the reality is, if something ships as part of an OS, applications ship as part of an OS, and it's sometimes you look at it and say, is that an app? Is it part of the OS? It's really hard to tell. And so what I'm able to do now is on any given vulnerability, randomly pick one, CVE 2010, ABC, 1234 or whatever, the affected products will say, oh, it's slash O for OS or slash A for application. So I was able to break out, this is something new in this report I wasn't able to do before, if it's either purely application, that's the top bars, so the only thing affected products were all listed as application only. And on the bottom, the bottom one is operating systems, if everything affected was purely OS. It wasn't application. If they had one product listed as OS and another product listing as an application, that's the green bar. So it's this muddy area in the middle, if you will. And so, for example, one example of that would be the IE, Internet Explorer browser, right? It gets listed as Internet Explorer an application. It also gets listed as part of Windows, the OS, and so it would fall in that green category there. So that's a little breakout. People are sometimes interested in the OS numbers. You can see they're up from 10 years ago, but you can also see they've been relatively flat from 2005 onward, that the growth in vuln disclosures is not coming from that space. It's been coming in the applications, and relative to the overall totals, the ones that are in that space of sometimes shipping with an OS but still an application seems to be a prime target area for the researchers. Okay, let's move on. I think that's this is the OS. The one's broken out. I don't really have anything more to say on that. Let's move on. I broke down OS vendors, vulnerability vendors. Let's go through these really quick because they echo the other. So this is just OS vulns. Enterprise Linux, next. Apple, next. And you see a big gap down to Microsoft, next. Linux kernel by itself shows up as an OS one as fourth, and the next Oracle showing up there. Oh, one thing I didn't say earlier is I do not include Oracle Unbreakable Linux, which is essentially Red Hat. Right, so they ship and support Oracle Unbreakable Linux, as they call it. It's pure, pure Red Hat, and they just simply take Red Hat fixes and pass them along to customers. They don't add any value, so to speak. I did not include those in Oracle numbers. So if you wanted to actually get true Oracle numbers on ones they support, you would include the Oracle number here plus the Enterprise Linux one, and they would be by far the number one contributor every single year. All right, let's move on. I think I've got thin applications, so you can see that follows the overall trend. Let's move on to so this was interesting to be able to do vendors by OS versus app. Because of that trend we've seen in researchers moving more towards apps. So let's roll through these. So the first is Google. That's because of Chrome. Oracle, that's largely because of Java as the app. Apple, these are Apple applications, so it does not include Mac OS in this number, but it would include Safari, for example, and fixes to iTunes show up a lot in that. Now for those of you that care about this stuff, they leverage WebKit. It's their own version, their own branch of WebKit. That's shared code to a large degree with Chrome, other browsers out there as well. They also leverage WebKit in iTunes and some of the other apps. There's certain aspects of it, so you'll see a lot of overlap between those different things. So if you see WebKit bombs, even if it hasn't been announced by some of these other vendors, you'll know that it typically also affects them as well. Adobe, of course, showing up when you look at apps themselves, and then finally IBM, which didn't show up in that top five or six list, but when you're looking at just apps, does show up from their products. So that's it. I went through it pretty quick. If you do have questions, also I encourage you that, like I say, I have that raw data out on the blog, so if you want to go look at yourselves, you can filter over whatever vendor you want. I do my best job at scrubbing the data. I don't scrub it from every vendor in the world, but you can post questions on the blog or email me as well. Yeah. Criticism as well, it's always welcome. I like to try to get the data better and better each time. With that, I'll turn it over to Tim, because I think he has way more interesting insights in terms of the malware trends.
Great. Thanks, Jeff. That was definitely interesting. I like to see that data. We're going to talk about malware trends over the last, as I mentioned, in some cases 20 years, focused on the last six because they're actually very interesting, more interesting than, you know, the prior 14. But so if we go on to the next slide, where do we get our data from for the Security Intelligence Report and a lot of the data we'll be talking about here today? Lots of different places. And so a lot of the data that we'll talk about here today comes from the sources that you see on the slide. Hotmail, for instance, we're scanning the inboxes for threats to Hotmail users. So malicious attachments, spam, phishing attacks, and so on. There's about 280 million active Hotmail users at any given time. And so it's a very active system, and we get lots of data on threats from it. Internet Explorer, obviously, the world's number one browser. There's several technologies built into IE in different versions of IE that we get telemetry data from. So Internet Explorer 7 has a phishing filter built into it that we get phishing data from and feeds into a reputation service that helps protect our customers. IE 8 and 9 have the phishing filter in addition to the smart screen filter, which is essentially antivirus inside the browser. And we get all sorts of data from these filters on, you know, what threats are coming through the browser, what's being downloaded, what's being blocked, and so on. Forefront Online Protection for Exchange, you know, literally scans billions of email messages for the corporate customers that use it, so their email flows through that system before then being forwarded onto their back-end Exchange systems on-premise. And so it's a multi-stage filtering system that allows us to do a bunch of analysis on the threats that we see flow in there, so spam, phishing, email attachments, and so on. Some of the other anti-malware tools that we get data from, such as the malicious software removal tool or MSRT, that runs in excess of, you know, 600 million systems around the world every month. It comes down with security updates on each second Tuesday of each month. And we get a massive amount of data on, you know, malware infections around the world. Another interesting one is the Microsoft Security Essentials, which is our consumer antivirus offering that does real-time protection. So where the MSRT gives us a view of post-exposure to malware, MSE shows us blocks. So it actually, since it's doing real-time, it's actually blocking malware from getting on the system. So it gives you a slightly different view of malware and what it's doing, how it's trying to attack a system, what happens when it gets onto the system, and so on. So it's a pretty, you know, well-rounded view of malware infections, specifically on consumer systems around the world. And then you get, you know, something like Bing, which is our search engine that goes and indexes billions of pages constantly, so that when you search on search terms, you know, it's able to find relevant results very, very quickly. As Bing indexes those billions of pages, it's also looking for drive-by download sites, malware hosting sites, phishing sites, and the like. And that feeds into a reputation service, so that if you actually search on something and one of the, you know, sites that comes up in the list of search results is a known bad, let's say, malware hosting site, it'll actually tell you that. It'll block you from going there and saying you don't really want to go to this site because it's a known bad site. But if you do, I mean, you can do these extra couple of clicks and get there. But it's preventing people from being exposed to, you know, these types of malicious sites. And so we get lots and lots of data from all of these different sources, and that's kind of the basis of what we'll be talking about today. So the next slide, what we did here is this is a 20-year view, if you will, of the growth of malware. And so what I did is I sat down with Jimmy Kuo, who is the senior researcher at Microsoft, senior antivirus researcher, who's worked in the industry for many years. He worked at McAfee for quite a while. He worked at Symantec and so on. And so he's, you know, he's a senior researcher. And what I did is I sat down with Jimmy and I said, so help me understand the growth of malware, what you saw back in the early days of the AV industry. And so what he did is he sat down and he looked at some of his past research and sort of put together this chart. And it's interesting because it depends, the answer to the question of how much malware is there depends on how you measure it. And so, you know, there's a bit of a debate in the AV industry about how much malware there is because it depends on how you count the samples that you get. And so what Jimmy did is he created this graph and he said, you know, it depends on how aggressive you want to get on counting. If you look at the inside line, the top line of that graph, that's if you're conservative, this is how many pieces of malware are out there. But if you want to count every variant of a known family, because of course there's server polymorphism and so on that generates variants, you know, thousands of them every single day, if you count that outside line, then you can get a much bigger estimate of how much malware is out there. And the reality is, regardless of how you count, I think everyone at this point will agree that in 2011, 2012, there's millions of pieces of malware, where back 20 years ago, there was really just about 1,000 different forms of malware. So just a massive explosion over the last 20 years of people getting into the malware creation business and then automating that in a big way. And so if we go to the next slide, this actually shows you the number of samples that we get in our lab in the Microsoft Malware Protection Center over a period of time. And I said we'd focus on the last 5-6 years, which is the best period in terms of both the data that we have and how reliable the data is, and really when the malicious activity really started to trend up in a big way. And so here you can see that up until about 1998, you were actually, you know, one option you had to receive, and probably the primary way people received antivirus signature updates and engine updates was on a floppy disk. You would actually get a floppy disk in the mail with your signature updates for that month. Which, if you think about today, is really funny because this stuff changes hourly, if not faster. It's constantly changing with variants, you know, constantly being served, you know, via server polymorphism. And so the idea that we could distribute, you know, signatures today via floppy disk is actually kind of funny. But if you think about it, up until about 1998, that's probably when they stopped, the AV industry stopped distributing signatures via floppy disk in the mail. And then you can see that the that the size of the signature started to increase from about 1 meg, which would fit on a floppy disk, to what we are today in 2012, which is in excess of 100 megabytes if you download a full signature set for one of the, you know, major AV offerings. So just a huge increase. And you got to realize that the other thing that happened during that period of time is that we went from just having a single signature for a piece of malware. Since they started, the attackers started to create variants very, very quickly of malware, the AV labs had to alter their approach and start writing generic signatures that were able to identify variants of malware with a single signature instead of a whole bunch of signatures for a whole bunch of malware. So what you're seeing is a huge increase in the amount of malware that's being authored and generated out there, and then the response is obvious, you know, a huge increase in both the complexity and effectiveness of anti-malware over time. And so the research and response capabilities of the AV vendors out there over time has just increased, you know, at an amazing pace, as you can see from the graph here. And so just in 2011, you know, the Microsoft Malware Protection Center received more than 49,000 different unique threat families, and inside each family, of course, you can have lots and lots of variants. And so, you know, most of those reported families were duplicates of polymorphic versions, you know, of key families that we saw throughout the year. So just lots of activity going on here. And that's one way to measure, you know, the growth of malware and the expansion of malware, evolution of malware over time. And so on the next series of slides, what I'm going to walk you through here is sort of a view of how I've seen attackers change their MOs over time. And they've evolved over time because as the software industry gets better and better and we get more security mitigation technologies built into the platforms and built into applications, the attackers change their modus operandi so that they continue to be successful. And so coming out of the era of big worms, you know, what I call the era of big worms, which is really an era between, say, 2002 and 2004, 2005, where we saw lots of mass mailing worms, so for instance, like Melissa and I Love You and those types of worms, and the network service worms, where you had a bunch of people trying to attack vulnerable network services, so threats that come to mind here are Code Red back in 2001. We had SQL Slammer and Blaster, you know, 2002, 2003, 2004 timeframe. So coming out of that big era of worms, you can see here on this slide the detections, the major malware detections of these worms going down a lot. So worms were making up about, you know, 40% of what we saw in the ecosystem back in the first half of 2006. So the way to read that bottom graph is 1H06 is first half of 2006, 2H06 second half of 2006, all the way to the second half of 2009, and then we get into quarterly data where we have the first quarter, you know, of 2004 and so on, all the way to the second quarter of 2011. So we got lots of data in there, and we're breaking it out quarterly at the end of that graph. And so you can see really the worms going way down because the industry focused on, and Microsoft focused on, blunting the ability of these worms to propagate. And that was the big deal with Windows XP SP2, turning on the firewall by default once and for all, which, you know, in every successive operating system since then, which really blunted the ability of worms to take advantage of network services that were listening on the network that may or may not have vulnerabilities in them, but we're allowing these worms to propagate. And so by turning on that firewall and then starting to patch these systems, you know, weekly and even then we moved on to monthly later on, it really blunted their ability to take advantage of network services. And then to do the mass mailing things, you know, we put in mitigations in Outlook and other email clients were, you know, also had mitigations added to them. And so it really blunted their ability to do the mass mailing worms and to do the network worms that we had seen. And you can see the percentage of worms being used go way, way down. Until recently, so then all of a sudden we saw an uptick of worm activity starting in about the second half of 2008, where worms like conficker, tatarif, and rime cud started to propagate. And these are blended threats, so instead of using a single vulnerability to spread the way that we saw blaster and slammer spread, they would use a blended approach where they use multiple, if applicable, multiple vulnerabilities they would attempt to exploit, or they would use social engineering, or they would use weak passwords. And we see these worms using all of those things. You take a threat like conficker, it uses weak passwords. And as we published in the last version of the SIR that we just released a few weeks ago, SIR V12, conficker, the number one way that it spreads three ways, through weak passwords, through social engineering, and then through unpatched vulnerabilities, MSO8067. The number one way it's being successful is through weak passwords by a long, long margin. And it uses auto run feature abuse to spread as well. And out of all of the ways that it propagates, we've identified that weak passwords is the way it's being successful. So you're seeing this sort of rise of worms here again in the last few years, which is actually very interesting. So then coming out of that big worm era, this is sort of what it would look like if you weren't around back then and saw what it would look like when Slammer, Blaster hit the system, or in this case, Zbot. You would get, a service would get, would crash, and then the service manager would offer up a prompt like you see here saying, well, the system's going to reboot in X number of seconds. And this was the case with Blaster, for instance, where you got a prompt just like this to tell you that a service had crashed. And so it was pretty obvious when a worm hit your system, and of course pretty painful as well. And so on the next slide, again, we get into the worms. The next big wave of attacks that we saw, or threats that we saw, were what we call miscellaneous potential when it's software. And this is really the very early versions of what we call rogue security software, fake antivirus software. And in this case, a threat like WinFixer is really using social engineering. So what you see here in this graph is worms going down because trying to exploit unpatched vulnerabilities simply isn't being as successful as it was in years past. So attackers switch tactics to social engineering. And so if we go to the next slide, this just shows you an example of WinFixer. It's telling you that instead of fake antivirus, it's really telling you about very poor performance, and you've got lots of things happening to the physical hard drive in your system, and you're going to lose data, and you know the system's slowing down with crashes and freezes and so on. Just enter your credit card number here to fix all of this stuff. So it's a very early version of the rogue antivirus software that you'll see here later in this presentation that's so popular for attackers today. And this was very prominent back in those days. And the point here is that they shifted from trying to exploit unpatched vulnerabilities to social engineering. And this is a tactic that we see to this day being used out there and successful. So this is, the rise of social engineering. And so if we go to the next trend, what we saw is social engineering sort of going up and down throughout in terms of prevalence, and you can see it's still being used in a big way today. In fact, it's going up again, as you can see from the graph. But the other thing we saw, probably the most severe threat that I think I've seen over the past 5 or 6 years, are the Trojan downloaders and droppers. And the best two examples of Trojan downloaders and droppers are Zlob and Rhinos. So the way Zlob would work is you would go to a site, and this was targeted at consumers primarily. You'd go to a site, and it would have some shiny content, new content that you wanted to get access to. It's either a document or a video or a game or something like this. And they'd tell you, they would trick you. It's, again, social engineering. So they would trick you into installing a Trojan on your system. So they'd say, oh, in order to watch the video, you need your system's missing the right video codec. So install this video codec, and you'll get access to the video. And, of course, the video codec is Zlob, the world's worst Trojan downloader dropper. And we remove this threat from millions and millions of systems around the world every 90 days. And, as you can see in the peak there in the second half of 2007 all the way into, 2009 and so on. And so this tactic started to trend down, as you can see from the graph. So on the next slide, we actually give you a pretty cool story here. Zlob is a threat where they were creating thousands of variants of Zlob every day. If your system got infected with Zlob, chances were that they were updating the client that they had on your system, the badware client that they had on your system, they were updating that probably, I saw 700 to 1,200 times a day. And so it would be very difficult for AV software to keep up with that pace, and this is where generic signatures come in and so on. So what happened is we really focused on ZLOB. It was the number one threat, number two threat in the world. Reno's number one, number two for many years, as you saw from the graph. So at one point, one of our AV partners submitted a sample of ZLOB that they had found on a system, and when our analysts analyzed it, lo and behold, there was a message from the authors of ZLOB telling us that they were closing up shop and moving on. Of course, it wasn't that we would continue to clean millions of systems around the world and try to put them out of business. They were just moving on to more interesting things. So, very interesting story. And shortly after that, you can see that, bam, the ZLOB threat and Trojan downloaders and droppers started to go down very, very quickly. And that's because ZLOB went from the number one, number two threat in the world every single period to not being in the top 20 period. And so ZLOB went away. Renos has held on even to this day. Renos is still showing up in the top 10 lists of many regions around the world. But Trojan downloaders and droppers sort of started to go out of style. Until recently, we published Survey 12, as I mentioned, just a couple of weeks ago, two, 3 weeks ago. One of the interesting aspects of Survey 12 is the rise of malware infection rates in a few countries, one of them, for instance, Germany, 30% rise in infection rate in Germany. When you take a look at the threats driving that trend there, lo and behold, we have the ISTI, Trojan downloader dropper, that's actually making huge headway in several key regions in the world. So Trojan downloaders and droppers are making a comeback here in the last half of 2011, moving into 2012. We'll see if they make it back onto this chart, but certainly they have, they've gone out of style, but they seem to be making a comeback at this point. So the next type of malware that we saw as Trojan downloaders and droppers started to decrease in prevalence because people, were starting to get wise to their tricks, AV software started to block the installation of this stuff, and all of their variants. The next big thing was what we call miscellaneous Trojans. Most of this was what we call rogue security software, fake antivirus software. And so we saw, again, this was, we had already seen this bag of tricks back in the second half, first half, in the second half of 2006, first half of 2007 with WinFixer, as I mentioned. But here we go again, history repeating itself, lots of rogue security software. And so here's some examples of different brands. We're removing rogue security software during this period of time from millions and millions of systems every 90 days around the world. Since then, these guys have started to localize their antivirus, fake antivirus offerings, rogue security software offerings into different languages. On the slide you can see, Korean in the center, that was a threat called OneScan that became the top threat in Korea and infecting and, us removing it from millions of systems in Korea over a period of time. That actually, we were able to remove that from the top 10 list of threats in Korea, and their infection rate went down very, very quickly. And now that one scan threat is back and infecting lots of other systems because they've made lots of changes to it and so on. And so we'll continue to fight that fight. You can also see here French. You can see that Mac has also had rogue security software on it as well. So this is a tactic they continue to use. We continue to remove this stuff from millions of systems around the world. If you're interested, I actually did a television interview on rogue security software or scareware. We did a blog on it on the Microsoft Security blog that Jeff mentioned earlier, and I think we have a link to that at the end of the presentation to the blog. If you're interested in watching that TV interview, it's up there on our most recent scareware post. Anyway, moving on, so that's fake antivirus software, again, which is pure social engineering. The other way it gets onto the system is if you get a downloader Trojan like Renos on a system, it installs it because they want to get access to the user's credit card number and so on. And so moving on, the next thing we saw, the big trend is in adware. Adware is actually a good thing because it's not a serious threat the way a Trojan downloader dropper is, or even fake antivirus software. But nonetheless, it is a threat to privacy. So it detects where you're going, it looks at your browsing habits, what you're searching on, and serves you up ads. So we saw a big increase in that because we saw a decrease in more severe threats in most places around the world. Since then, as we've published in Survey 12 here recently, adware has actually gone down in prevalence because now we're starting to see other severe threats start to go up in prevalence. So it's a pretty interesting trend. This just gives you some examples of some of the adware out there, like Porn Pop, that is a pop under a hot bar that detects where you're searching through their search bar, and Click Potato does the same thing. So from adware, of course, the next big trend that we see is that's always been there has been these password stealers and monitoring tools. Most of this is around two things: online banking, as we see in Brazil every single year with bankless and banker threats that target the top five banks there, and then more globally, FretHog, which is a password stealer that focuses on games like World of Warcraft, Legend of Mirror, Lineage, and so on. So that's sort of what the trends look like over time, all the big malware trends. Moving on, some of the places that we see the highest malware infection rates in the world, you can see here on the slide. Very interesting because we see places like Turkey to be very, you know, to have been infected for quite some time. In the Survey 12 data that we released just a few weeks ago, Turkey is indeed still in the top five most impacted regions. Interestingly, most of these other regions have made a little bit of progress and continued to reduce their infection rates, like Korea and Spain. Other places like Pakistan, the Palestinian Authority, Albania, and Egypt have now popped up into the top five list of most infected places in the world. Least infected, this is pretty interesting. We call them the usual suspects because they've consistently had low infection rates. Places like Austria, Germany, Japan, and Finland. And so a lot of people will ask me when I talk to them about those threats, what are they doing there that's so, you know, so much better than what we're doing in other parts of the world? And so looking at the top threats in Finland, you can see that they're mostly adware. And as I mentioned earlier, adware is probably one of the least severe types of threats that you have because it's not, at least it's not, it doesn't allow someone to remote control your system and so on. And so as you can see in Finland, it's sort of an interesting threat landscape there and the types of infections that we find there. So things like Rhinos, which is a Trojan downloader that I told you about earlier, number one, number two in the world for a long time, is really at low levels in Finland. Something like FakeRheem, that is rogue security software, fake antivirus software. Again, very low levels because if you look at the United States, FakeRheem is like number one. And so very interesting mix, most of which is sort of benign like adware. So, what do we do? What do we learn from this? If we go on to the next slide, you can see that what we did is we created a blog series called Lessons from the Least Malware-Infected Regions in the World. And what I did is I did a blog post on each one of the regions that I mentioned, Austria, Finland, Germany, Japan, and then a finale where I kind of aggregate all of the findings and all of the things that we learned from talking to security experts in these different regions and looking at the data in the SIR and so on. And so just telling you what we learned from those folks, some of the high-level lessons that I blogged about in that series and that we actually printed in the SIR, strong public-private partnerships, so between government and industry, that's really, really key and a key part of the cleanest regions in the world and what they're doing right. ISPs and certs are actively engaged, the ISPs specifically monitoring their environments and being very responsive to malware infections that their customers are having. That's pretty key. IT culture where administrators are on top of these things is also key. Administrators being very, very active and very, very timely is very helpful in these regions. Enforcement policies, so actually having an enforcement policy, specifically ISPs, looking at malwares, infections, and then having a policy about what to do about them, how to help the customers on that network and keep the rest of the network clean is very, very key. Education campaigns and media focus help. For instance, in Korea, getting that rogue AV software one scan off the top 10 list, that was all user awareness. And so it can be very effective. Low software piracy rates, so we know that places that have high piracy rates typically have high malware infection rates as well. And so these regions that we're talking about here with the lowest malware infection rates consistently in the world generally have very low piracy rates as well. And then finally, keeping software up to date. In the past, we've published Windows Update, Microsoft Update usage, and done studies that show places that have low usage rates also have high piracy rates and also have high malware infection rates. So keeping systems up to date is pretty critical as well. And so the other thing we released at RSA this year was this case study on a company in Finland, the largest ISP in Europe, called Tila Sonera, which runs the cleanest, largest network in Europe, which is very cool to see. So it's the cleanest network in the cleanest country. And what we did is we went and talked to these folks and said, how are you doing it? What can other people learn from your example? And what we did was learn that what they're doing is when they find someone infected on their network, they put them into a walled garden, so they're quarantined. They're able to access AV downloads, they're able to access, you know, antivirus companies and so on, protection provider companies and so on, but they're not able to get unfettered access to the internet because that's one way that a lot of other people on the network would get infected from them. And so they take a pretty interesting approach to quarantining. They will contact the customer on their network via text, so they have the text number on file for the customer, and they will text the customer. If they don't get a reply or response from the customers, to the text, they'll use actual regular mail to communicate with them as well, and they will help that customer get cleaned up. Once the customer gets cleaned up, they get put back onto the general internet and access everything, and they've been able to actually keep the network amazingly clean this way, and they're actually able to process hundreds of customers every hour, where before moving to this model, it would take them many hours to clean up a single customer, and thus it was a very slow system. So the case study is also available on Microsoft.com/SIR if you're interested in the particulars. All right, so one of the things I get asked often when we talk about this type of data is, well, what's the difference between what consumers are being infected with and what enterprises are being infected with? Here you can see the non-domain joined computers are the ones that we consider home computers or consumer systems. Have been infected mostly with recently adware, as we saw in the long-term trend, which is interesting. And a threat like Conficker is really low on the list, where if you see over on the domain joined systems, which are primarily enterprise systems, Conficker is the number one threat. And even when we published the SIR here recently, just a few weeks ago, Conficker is still the number one threat in the enterprise. And as I mentioned earlier in the session, weak passwords, ridiculously weak passwords, are the thing that allows Conficker to continue to be successful in enterprise environments. So the key there is to implement strong password policies and enforce them, because password 123 is being used by Conficker in all its variants. And now, with all the concern around advanced persistent threat, or what we call targeted attacks by determined adversaries, if Conficker, which is a three-year-old threat, we haven't seen a new variant in 2.5 years. If it's able to use a hard-coded list of passwords, simple passwords to propagate, why would an attacker that's determined to get into your environment have to do anything really advanced when they can just use simple passwords to compromise your environment? And so that's it. I think we can open it up for questions at this point, right, Jeff?
Yep.
Okay, great. We're kind of running out of time. So it's really important that you look at the blog, because you can send your questions directly to Jeff or Tim or through Twitter. But I do have one question. I don't think I heard you mention the benefits of removing admin privilege from users or for home users running non-admin most of the time, using admin privileges only when necessary.
Yeah, I think that over time, we've certainly seen lots and lots of guidance in the security community to run in least privilege. That's helpful. We have not done a study in the SIR yet where we've analyzed malware to see, is it actually successful using admin or non-admin? Is there a difference between using an admin privileged account versus a non-admin privileged account? Certainly, there's a lot of anecdotal data that suggests that running a non-admin to surf the internet, for instance, is very advantageous. but we don't have any hardcore data. We haven't done a study on malware in the past to have any data that suggests just how effective of a tactic that is. But certainly from an anecdotal point of view, that is a very good piece of guidance.
Yeah, I mean, I'll add that it's a tough thing to generalize and analyze at scale. It's good guidance. We'd certainly promote it, and I think you're right to call that out. But from this malware point of view, if I'm running as non-admin, which I do, and I go and click or do one of these things, I'll still get the infection. It'll still get cleaned. The difference or the benefit, as you're referring to, of course, is that it will limit what it could do. It limit to just my user account. Would be harder to install itself as root, those sorts of things. So that's a good call out. That's good advice to follow. Harder for us to study at scale, but something interesting to look for.
Okay, well, unfortunately we're out of time, but Tim and Jeff, thank you so much for your session. Really appreciate it. And stay tuned next month, June 27th, will be our next webcast.
Well, thanks for having us, and thanks everyone for attending today.